Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Expedition Summerlands by Nathaniel Webb, narrated by Emily Beresford. The Merchandise Machine. At the exact moment I earned my Summerlands fee, I was deep in the guts of a merchandise machine, ringing a bell. I'd worked out the day and hour months ago. At 4 p.m. Hollywood adjusted time, my daily pay card incremented just enough that when I swiped it into my bank account that night, it would put me over $10,000. The price of a ticket to the Summerlands. I swept the bell through a complex pattern that supposedly, if I performed it in the Summerlands, would produce a small flame capable of lighting a candle or lantern. At the final flourish, I flicked my wrist a little too vigorously, and the bell slipped from my fingers and landed with a clatter on the floor of the narrow maintenance access tube where I sat. I picked up the bell, wiped off a little machine oil, and stowed it in a plastic freezer bag with a few quarters and a folding pocket knife. I crammed the bag into a pocket of my uniform as I double-checked the solders I'd been sent in to make, which were solid and shiny. Satisfied, I scooted down my butt until I lay flat on my back. I took a breath, reached up, and clicked a glowing orange switch above me into the on position. The machine roared to life around me. I could feel its gears getting up to speed as I wiggled my way down the maintenance tube, the tip of my nose almost scraping the oiled metal above me. By regulations, I had 30 seconds to get out of the tube before the merch machine started running again. But most managers had their techs shorten this startup time, and mine was no different. I'd done the work myself on this one. I dropped out of the tube with 5 seconds to spare and found my manager, Mr. Fessy, waiting for me. He stood with his arms crossed, a phone in one hand, in front of a small mob of impatient customers. He was a round man with a red face and a bushy white mustache that almost distracted from his thinning hair. At my full height, about 5 feet 7 inches, tall for my parents' income, I looked him right in the eye. We wore identical black shirts stitched with the silver badge of Expedition Games, our mutual employer, but mine ballooned out around me, while Mr. Fessy's threatened to pop its buttons. The cracked touch screens on the merch machine flickered and came to life, and the shoppers surrounded me and Mr. Fessy as they surged forward. I watched them for a moment as they swiped their pay cards into the machine, then tapped through touchscreen menus to find the products they wanted. T-shirts, shot glasses, posters, video cards, plush monster toys, and boxes of hair dye dropped from the machine as quickly as their buyers could snatch them up. Mr. Fessy cleared his throat and smoothed his mustache with his free hand, a nervous tic that I had learned to associate with big news, usually layoffs.
"That was very good, Emma," he said, glancing at his phone. "Target completion time for that procedure is 17 minutes. Took you only 14:35.
I'd actually had done the job in less than 8 and spent the rest of the time working with my bell, but I wasn't about to mention that. The interior of the merch machine was the only spot in the Expedition store not watched by security cameras, which made it perfect for some secret magic practice.
"Anyway, end of shift," Mr. Fessy continued. "Here's your pay."
He handed over a pay card, which I pocketed, repeating the mental math I'd performed 100 times in the last week. $92.50 for a 10-hour shift, less 20% in federal taxes, 5% in zone taxes, 5% police insurance, 2% fire insurance. In all, there should be $62.90 on the card, just enough to get me to $10,000 after the bank took its insurance cut.
"One more thing," said Mr. Fessy,
pulling me from my mathematical reverie.
"Mr. Schneider died yesterday."
"Oh, I'm so sorry," I said. Mr. Schneider had been an uncaring assistant manager, happy to arrive late and leave early. He was quick with a cruel word when he didn't like my performance, but I most often found him in an opiate haze in the employee bathroom, his acne-cratered face slack, far beyond words for me or anyone else. Still, I wouldn't have wished him dead. We all had our methods of escaping the real world. I spent every day dreaming that I would make it to the Summerlands, and I had the gift of 3 best friends who shared my plan. Jason, Cass, Noah, and I could count on each other for encouragement when gray reality pressed in, and the Summerlands were too far away. I suspected Mr. Schneider had had nobody to fall back on.
"Anyway," said Mr. Fessy, "I clocked you out. See you tomorrow."
I made my way towards the front of the store, weaving around eager Summerlands fans as they picked through the display merchandise. I'd long since learned to tune out the blare of advertising all around me. Rows of flat screens played up to the second live streams from all the big-name adventurers. Valkyrie and Rad were sparring, their feeds showing alternate views of the same fight. Pixie was talking directly to her camera, a pink bra strap and soft white skin showing where her tunic had slipped artfully from her shoulder. St. George was sleeping. A knot of kids, too poor to afford to watch at home, stood staring at the feeds as flickering colors played across their rapt faces. I couldn't blame them. If they missed something especially thrilling or momentous on the feeds, they'd be completely left out at school tomorrow. One of them, a girl in oversized clothes, turned and gave me a little wave that said, "Thanks for not kicking us out." I smiled and waved back. I was almost to the front doors when a boy cut me off, stepping from behind a t-shirt display to put himself between me and the exit. I recognized him instantly. Jamie Bullard. He lived in my apartment block and had been a couple years behind me in high school. His crisp haircut, round red cheeks, and little gut hiding under a brand name Valkyrie t-shirt all illustrated the most important fact about Jamie. His father was the chief of police, which made him the richest kid on the block.
"Hey, Burke," he said. "You pull anything out of the prize machine for me?"
"It's not a prize machine. It's a merch machine." I tried to stand up as tall as I could. "If you want something, you can buy it."
"Come on. I know techs get full access."
He had a sort of whiny voice for such a big guy.
"My allowance ran out. Just hook me up. I won't tell."
"You know I can't do that, Jamie."
Fine.
He deflated a little, letting air out of his tough guy posture.
"How's training going? You're looking fit."
I blinked at the sudden change in tone. "Oh, thanks. Cass works us hard."
"You must be close to having enough, yeah? You guys really gonna do it?"
That's the $10,000 question, I thought. We'd spent 5 years saving, and now the Summerlands were within reach. With my own fee banked, I could start putting money towards the others. Cass was almost as close as I was. Jason made decent money working swing shift at a factory, but he was still in school, so he couldn't work full-time. Noah was lagging behind, but now I could help him. "We're not there yet," I said.
"Yeah, I have a hard time seeing you killing rats."
Jamie shrugged.
"Be cool if you were famous, though."
"I guess." I looked at my sneakers, which really needed replacing. Jamie crossed his arms.
"You better give me free Heart Hammer merch."
It took me the better part of an hour to get home, walking my usual route through a broken and abandoned highway. The anticipation of telling my friends was a buzz of fear and elation in my stomach, and I couldn't keep my right hand from diving into my pocket to touch my pay card every few seconds. It sat there like a stone, and yet I was constantly certain it had disappeared. I walked past a clutch of big white houses that sat in a wide bowl of dead grass just off the street. Their windows were mostly cracked or missing, and a dozen black power lines made a drooping spiderweb between the houses and a half-fallen electrical pole. Jason and Cass's dad, Mr. Keats, though I had always just called him Keats, had told me once that the houses were all owned as investments by rich folks waiting for the prices to rebound. They'd been waiting longer than I'd been alive. A policeman stood on the weedy shoulder of the road between me and the abandoned homes, tapping his fingers on a bud of an armalite slung across his chest, his head swiveling to follow me as I passed. I gave him a wave. I'd passed him at this same spot nearly every day for years. But his expression, hidden behind black shades, didn't change. Between the brown grass, the black asphalt of the neglected highway, and the orange-gray clouded sky, it was a dismal landscape I walked through. Even I could see that, and I'd never known anything else. But today, the money in my pocket made me feel daring enough to call unnecessary police attention to myself. Not because it made me rich, but because it made me a promise. A better world. Between the strip mall and my apartment block, one crisp rectangle of bright color showed against all the washed-out gray. A billboard for the Summerlands stood about half a mile from my block, and it looked quite literally like a window into another reality. On the billboard, A skinny, handsome, light-skinned man with salt-and-pepper hair and a neat beard stood holding a sword in one hand and a bell in the other. Behind him were the perfect blue sky and rolling green hills of the Summerlands. He wore lush red wizard's robes and a necklace of sea-green jewels. His name was Dr. Agony, and if anybody was the face of the Summerlands, it was him. Because the Summerlands wasn't just a place, it was a game, and he was the man who'd built it. Back in 2055, Expedition Games was the leading developer of VR and sense-around games. Dr. Agony, also known by his real name, Dr. James Agostino, was their chief designer and coder. So it fell to Dr. Agony to make the announcements that changed everything. Expedition Games had found a portal to another world. The portal was in the European Union, on a craggy island in the North Sea, at the northernmost extremity of a country my history text called Scotland. In a patch of reclaimed wilderness that was part of Expedition's real estate holdings was a small crofter's homestead that had collapsed long ago. Beside the low stone rectangle that had once been a peat-roofed house, there was a well. At the bottom of the well was a ring of luminescent moss. And on the other side of the ring was a world they called the Summerlands. At first, people were just confused. Most of us took it for a marketing tactic. Expedition had probably come up with some slick new VR technology, and the whole different world thing was metaphorical. Then, once we all understood what they were claiming, nobody bought it. But soon the feeds started. A team of Expedition employees called the First Ranger Group, led by Dr. Agony, sent back live HD video streams of a world with green grass, blue skies, clear rivers, and gleaming white ruins. And then we had to believe, because nowhere like that existed on Earth anymore. For months, the world was enthralled just watching the First Ranger Group explore this new Eden. Expedition Games claimed all the territory the Rangers covered in the Summerlands. They certainly owned the well and the portal, and their lawyers argued convincingly that the laws of Earth's nations ended where other worlds began. Then, just as the second-hand thrill of the Rangers' exploration feeds was wearing off, tragedy struck. A ranger group led by Dr. Agony himself made camp at the outskirts of a huge forest. They shut their cameras off for the night. The next time their feed came online, some 20 hours later, every ranger was dead, except for Agony himself. Expedition weathered a tsunami of demand from the public to explain what had happened, even stared down a congressional investigation. But they refused to disclose the fate of what became known as the Lost Expedition. Instead, they marked off a wide circle of land, built a huge wall along the border, and revealed Dr. Agony's master plan. He was making a game. First, they built a city. Called Wellpoint, it was a full-scale model of a fantasy medieval town, all plaster and stone and exposed beams. Some of the materials were brought over from Earth, but most were harvested from the seemingly endless resources of the Summerlands. In the center of Wellpoint, surrounded by a cobblestone town square, stood a green glowing moss circle that matched the portal in our world. Next, Expedition started hiring. Noah, Cass, Jason, and I were too young to apply, but it probably wouldn't have mattered anyway. They received something like 500,000 applications for maybe 200 jobs. They quickly filled out 7 more ranger groups, whom they sent off to map the new world, with a particular eye for caves, ruins, and dungeons where treasure might hide. The rangers were the first to find the monsters that seemed to lurk anywhere there were riches to be found. They named them gold dogs, trash snakes, giant hell rats. The town of Wellpoint grew, and Expedition took on applicants to act as the everyday people of the world. You could be a town guard, a ditch digger, a blacksmith, a shopkeep, anything Expedition needed to keep their new fantasy world running. If you had the skills, all they asked was a lifetime contract. It was during this period that Dr. Agony discovered magic. A cache of books in what appeared to be an ancient temple suggested a codified system of spells, but the texts resisted translation for weeks. Until one day, Dr. Agony announced that he could speak and read the language of the people who had once occupied the Summerlands. The Book of Elvish Magic was published a month later and rode the bestseller lists for a year. I read my copy over and over until it fell apart, learning that magic came in 2 types and relied on the help of ritual implements. Dr. Agony was what he called a red magician, casting flashy spells with coins, swords, bells, and jewels. I also practiced red magic, not that I could afford jewels. Noah was our white magician. He amassed a small trove of wands, bracelets, cups, and gloves as he practiced from his own copy of the book. Finally, after 3 years of frenzied anticipation and round-the-clock media coverage, Expedition opened their new game to beta testers. A spot on the beta list cost $250,000. It filled up in 4 hours. One by one, the new players passed through the portal to the Summerlands. They were stripped of all their possessions and sent through with nothing but some pseudo-medieval clothing, a handful of copper coins, and a camera drone. The drones were the only concession to modern technology in the game, and Expedition Games was notoriously strict about enforcing the rules of their new wonderland. A would-be player once tried to smuggle in a handgun, and he'd been caught and banned for life. No refund on the ticket fee, which was $150,000 at that point. Before you passed through, you were implanted with a subdermal RFID chip, and on the other side, you were given a drone keyed to your particular signal. 25 hours a day. Time worked a little differently in the Summerlands. Your drone sent back a live feed of whatever you were up to. With the beta open, Dr. Agony quit his job with Expedition to become a full-time adventurer, handing over the reins to his protege, a woman named Blomhaugen. Some fans complained that he had an unfair advantage, but as the earliest players learned how to navigate their new world, Agony swiftly established himself as having the most interesting and exciting feed to watch. The beta players quickly formed adventuring parties, and the most talented ones started guilds to share their knowledge. For a fee, of course. The less talented chickened out and opened shops and restaurants rather than risk their lives. Others returned home via the portal and hit the talk show circuit. But the adventurers who stuck with it soon found that there were really only two good ways to get rich in the Summerlands. The most obvious was to go out adventuring and make it back to Wellpoint laden with treasure. The ranger groups did their job well, and there seemed to be no shortage of abandoned buildings crammed full of coins, jewelry, and other treasure. The other way was to have a popular feed. Advertisers were happy to pour cash into the accounts of big-name streamers like Dr. Agony, and in return, plaster their likenesses across any and all merchandise. The more viewers you had, the more you could make in sponsorships. But if you turned off your stream, your fans would change channel. Still, some players lived mostly off the airwaves, streaming only in the midst of something exciting. Most killed their streams when they were doing something really mundane, like sleeping or using the bathroom. Some didn't. There was a market for that. Some people streamed their lives in confessional form, showing everything 24/7 and talking nonstop about their emotions through every gold coin found and every friend lost to a monster. A few even had made the leap to porn, teasing, stripping, even sleeping with other players and beaming every detail back to a thirsty public. They always had the nicest clothes. The Summerlands had been open for 5 years. Beta tester spots were $250,000 each. Tickets were down to 200,000 at the official launch. After the early adopters and rich kids had bought in, and especially once people started getting killed, the real price cuts began. My friends and I had spent that entire time saving money. We'd played a lot of other games, Expedition's VR offerings, old 2D games that Keats had collected, even some pen and paper role-playing games. But the Summerlands captured our imagination instantly. It promised an exit from the gray landscape around us. And more than that, it was a place with a whole new set of rules. In the Summerlands, it would be us against the world. The treasure that hid underground was ours for the taking. The monsters that stood between us and glory could be slain. Everyone started with nothing. Everyone lived or died by their skill alone. That was more than could be said for real life. Hearthammer. All four members of my would-be adventuring party lived in the same apartment block, a cross made up of 4 20-story buildings with a small shared outdoor space in the center. As I turned from the street to the weedy cement path that led to my door, a few kids from the block ran past, laughing as they chased after a dust-caked ball.
You there!
I had my head down as I rounded the last corner between me and my door, so I saw the cop's gleaming black boots first. My heart choked and froze. As I looked up in resignation, I took in the heavy slate-gray jodhpurs, black leather belt slung with gear, Kevlar vest, and rifle butt jutting out from behind it all. But when I finally saw the deep scowl creasing the cop's face, I burst out laughing. Oh, Christ, Keats! You scared me!
I got you, didn't I?
David Keats's face split in a grin. Raising Cassidy and Jason on his own had given Keats a knack for throwing on a serious face at a moment's notice. But if you knew him well enough, you could see the laughter in his pale blue eyes, no matter how hard he tried to hide it. God, I really bought it, too! Oh, I should have known. I shook my head to try and hide my own smile. And you shouldn't be lurking around scaring people.
Lurking around scaring people is half my job, said Keats. But actually, I just wanted to invite you to dinner. You eaten yet?
You know I haven't. Stopping for fast food isn't on the Cassidy Keats fantasy adventure diet plan.
Perfect. He slapped me on the shoulder. Come on, you can wake Jason up for his shift.
You know, I said as Keats held the rusting metal door of our building open for me, you probably don't have to personally invite me to dine every single night.
No,
he asked, following me in. The long hallway light flickered and buzzed above our heads as the door clicked shut, and I thought for the 100th time that I really ought to rewire it. I mean, I think Noah and I have just assumed a standing invitation for the last few years.
Well, said Keats, adjusting the shoulder strap of his Armalite, there's nothing wrong with a little etiquette. Even if the world is rude, we can still be polite.
That's very deep, Keats, I said, and he laughed. Speaking of polite, any chance tonight will be the night? We were side by side on the clanging metal fire stairs now. The elevators had been busted since before I was born, and I could see the shine of sweat at Keats's receding hairline. He was a strong man, a full 6 feet tall with thick arms, but over my lifetime, I'd watched his belly grow steadily out over his belt. He took a wheezy breath before he replied.
Night for what?
The night you finally let me pay for dinner, or at least some of it. Keats was already shaking his head, but I soldiered on. Come on, I just got paid. Let me cover my part, at least.
No chance, he puffed. Least I can do is feed my kids, Emma.
You know I'm not actually your kid, right? And neither is Noah. At best, we've got squatter's rights.
David Keats just shrugged and shifted his assault rifle on his shoulder.
Jason, the younger of Keats's two kids and the junior member of our adventuring party, was snoring terribly, tangled in the sheets of the upper bunk bed in the room he shared with his sister Cass. I reached up and shoved the metal lattice beneath his mattress, bouncing him awake as I sang, "You gotta get up in the morning! You gotta get up with the sun!" Jason half fell, half slid down the ladder, his eyes still closed. He was naked except for a pair of ratty boxers. The Keats family's apartment captured a lot of the heat from the lower floors, a blessing in winter, and a curse the other 10 months of the year. As Jason stumbled around his room, looking for pants and quietly cursing me, I couldn't help but appreciate how much he'd changed. His father's pale blue eyes still shone bright against his mother's brown skin, but he'd grown a few more inches in the last year. Between his factory job, our relentless combat practice, and a decent diet, we had Cass to thank for the last two. He'd put on a lot of muscle as well. He'd recently buzzed his thick brown hair, and the shortcut drew attention to the sharp angles of his new cheekbones and jawline. I wasn't about to say all that, though, so instead I told him he was a lazy bum who slept all day.
All day? All day? He grumbled from behind his open closet door.
I watched the old boxers come flying over the door and saw a foot and a hint of calf as he stood one-legged to pull the new ones on.
All day I'm in school. All night I work.
Yeah, what are roll bars anyway? I teased, but he ignored me.
Not being a dropout makes Dad happy. So school, that's Dad time. I work 4 hours a night and save every penny for my ticket, so that's Summerlands time. But afternoon, that's nap time. That's Jason time!
He came out from behind the closet door, wearing a blue factory jumpsuit with the name Buck stitched onto a tag on the chest.
Why am I awake, Emma? What happened to Jason time?
It's not Jason time, I replied. It's dinner time. Come on, Buck. He sighed dramatically.
Only one more year to graduation. Then I can go full-time and really live my dream of being a factory worker.
I won't stand for that kind of talk, adventurer,
barked Cass from the doorway. Jason stiffened to mock attention, then ducked sharply as Cass flung a sweaty towel at him. She was 2 inches shorter than her younger brother, and slimmer, and she looked like a color-inverted photo of him with her father's sun-reddened white skin and her mother's deep brown eyes. They shared the same cheekbones, though, and in a sweat-darkened gray tank top, her muscles stood out just as sharply, toned from 5 years of drawing a heavy yew longbow. Her hair was clipped as short as Jason's on the sides, with an unruly brown tangle on top. "How are the piggy banks?" I asked, just as Cass dove her sweat-gleaming face into a fresh towel. Cass was a personal trainer, trying to reverse years of neglectful parenting that had led the children of wealthy families to obesity. The job had always struck me as a ridiculous luxury. It was hard to blame the kids I'd grown up with for being so unhealthy. Considering a sugared meat patty at Cluckaduck's was the cheapest meal in town by far. But surely the few rich families, the ones with houses to themselves, could put real food on the table every night.
I get paid to work out, replied Cass, coming up for air.
That was how she always deflected the question, but she loved to run and jump and climb on obstacle courses she built for kids who were, like all of us, huge fans of Summerlands streams. I'd once watched her grab a wooden sword and chase a group of 8-year-olds in a circle for half an hour as they shrieked with laughter, yelling that she was an elf come back to steal their gold.
Hey, said Jason suddenly.
He was looking down at his phone, his dark eyebrows pressed together.
Do you guys remember Tara?
Your online girlfriend? Said Cass.
She's not, Jason started.
She's just a girl who's your friend. Online.
Cass laughed as Jason blushed.
Oh, and I've never met her because she's from the EU.
What about her? I asked.
Well, we haven't talked in a while, Jason said. I've been busy with school and work and everything. But she just messaged me out of the blue. It just says Summerlands Discovery, 2054. And,
he held up his phone,
there's like 10 megs of files attached.
It's probably a virus, I said. Her account got hacked or something. You shouldn't open it.
I guess.
Jason stuck his phone in a pocket of his jumpsuit.
Come on, I'm hungry.
With Jason and Cass more or less dressed and clean, we crossed the hall to the Keats's little kitchenette slash dining room. Their apartment was cozy and simple. The front door opened into a hallway with 4 doors. Jason and Cass's room was on the left, followed by the bathroom, and on the right were the kitchen and Keats's room. As an only child, I could only guess at the morning havoc in the bathroom. But otherwise, it seemed like a nice place to grow up. In the kitchen, Keats stood at the stove, flipping protein slabs on a frying pan, like a chef in an ad for an upscale pancake house. On the second burner, a pot of pasta was boiling.
Looks perfect, Dad, said Cass as we came in.
Looks boring, you mean? Said Keats with a laugh.
He uncomplainingly cooked Cass's training diet for us, morning and night. But during the day, I think he had no compunctions helping himself to whatever snacks the police department's corporate sponsors had left at the station.
Where's Noah? Asked Jason. He's never late for dinner.
Noah Garcia Benatar was the 4th member of our party, and Jason was right. Noah never missed a meal at the Keats's place.
Good question.
Keats banged on the wall above the stove with his spatula.
Noah, food!
A moment later, Noah appeared at the door of the kitchenette, an open book in one hand and 2 more in the other. He had thick, wavy black hair and thick eyebrows and a long nose below wide brown eyes. He was shorter than even me, but much broader, another of Cass's training success stories.
Noah, how long have you been in my room?
Keats asked. His bedroom was on the other side of the wall, just big enough for a twin bed and a tall bookshelf overflowing with science fiction novels from the last century.
You said I could look at the new books you got, said Noah matter-of-factly. That was...
Keats glanced at his police-issue phone on the counter.
9 hours ago.
Oh, said Noah. He had a funny sort of straightforwardness to him, like he didn't really understand everyday concepts, such as boredom or fatigue or laziness. When he found a book he liked, he would read it until he finished it, or somebody told him to stop. When Cass told him he needed to start doing an hour of cardio and 2 of weights daily, he was out in the dust fields the next day, lifting and running in the hazy orange sunlight. It was as though the idea of not doing something simply never occurred to him.
Naturally, this made it hard for most people to understand him, and Noah had been pretty badly bullied at school until he found us. On top of his dedication to our training, he was our walking encyclopedia, even more obsessed with the Summerlands than the rest of us. He usually didn't say much, but if you got him going on some piece of lore, he could talk forever. 2 years earlier, we'd taken the bus to San Diego for a Summerlands fan convention. I sat next to him, and he spent the entire 3 hours telling me how every mountain in the Summerlands had gotten its name. We adored him. Protein chopped into pasta made a filling, if bland, meal, and after we'd all had enough, we sat around the Keats's chipped formica table, momentarily too full to move. "So, I have an announcement," I said, breaking the contented silence. Cass sat up straight, her eyes keen. Jason raised an eyebrow. Even Noah looked up from his book. I cleared my throat a couple times. Then, deciding to go for forthrightness over showmanship, dove in. "Once I put today's pay card in the bank, I'll have a little over 10,000. The room went off like a fireball spell. Cass leapt up with a whoop, knocking over her chair. Noah was smiling and clapping. Jason and his dad were shouting, "Did you know? I didn't know!" back and forth at each other. I just sat there, feeling my cheeks grow red hot. "It's not that big a deal," I eventually interjected. "We still have to get you guys to 10K.
"Are you excited?" asked Noah. "You don't seem excited."
"No, I'm excited," I insisted. It's just a lot more real now, that's all."
"What?" Cass yelped. "Don't tell me you're getting cold feet now. It's finally happening for us."
No, of course not," I stammered. I trailed off.
"I have a question," said Keats, changing the subject with merciful bluntness. "Before you actually get there, what are you all looking forward to most about the Summerlands? Cass?"
"Kicking ass, obviously," said
Cass, still standing over me with her hands on her hips. She hadn't noticed her dad's act of conversational mercy, or maybe she just couldn't stand to miss a chance to boast.
"We're going to be the best adventuring party the Summerlands has ever seen. Untouchable."
"Untouchable is good," her dad agreed. "Jason?"
"Well, honestly,"
Jason wrinkled his nose,
"it'll be kind of nice not to worry about money for once. When we start winning it, I mean. I think there's a lot of gold still sitting out there for us to grab."
"Oh, yeah?"
said Keats, smiling.
"What's the first thing you're going to buy when you're rich?"
"A house for you,"
said Jason, not meeting his dad's eyes.
"A real one."
"I can't wait to meet everyone," said Noah. "Dr. Agony will be there. St. George. Rad is a hecker, you know."
"We know," laughed Jason.
Hecker was the slang term from someone from the Hexy, the Hollywood Economic Cooperation Zone. People like us.
"Why do you want to meet St. George? That dude's a psycho."
"He seems interesting," said Noah. "And he has more confirmed kills than any other player." "How about you, Emma?" asked Keats. "What are you excited about?"
"Everybody took mine," I hedged. But Keats held me pinned by his stare, refusing to let me off that easily. "But I guess... okay, has it ever bothered you that there are no scientists in the Summerlands?"
"Huh?"
Cass looked blank, as did her brother. But Noah seemed attentive.
"Well, think about it," I went on. "The Summerlands was gamified immediately after it was discovered. Aside from the Rangers, nobody's ever really studied it right. I mean, this whole other world, and we made it into a theme park. There's all kinds of plants and animals and elven architecture. We don't even know for sure that the elves are all gone."
"Elves? Seriously?" Cass's eyebrows drew together. Expedition Games had concluded that the elves were long dead, and that was enough for her.
"Or whatever," I said. "But don't you think someone should be, I don't know, taking notes?"
"First scientist of the Summerlands," said Keats.
He smiled, but there was a sadness in his crinkled eyes, the look of a man watching his kids grow up.
"I have a feeling we're all going to remember tonight. The first, biggest step on the road of the rest of your lives. So let me give you some fatherly advice, if that's okay."
We all nodded, his sudden serious turn cutting through our jangled nerves.
"Whatever happens on the other side, whether you guys get rich or get famous or decide to just stay in town and run a shop, which is fine by me, by the way,
seems a lot safer than dungeon diving.
Once you get to the Summerlands, you've already won.
Just being there is a victory, a big one. That's a better life than anything I could give you here.
He waved a big hand vaguely at the window at the back of the room, which looked out on a battered metal fire escape and a dust-choked alley beyond it.
Look at the ground. Look at the sky. You're too young to remember how things used to be, but I'm not. I remember how it was before we all went too far as a society. So when you get there, don't go too far.
After dinner, we crammed into Cass and Jason's little room. Jason and I shared Cass's bunk as she paced back and forth, all nervous energy. Noah sat on the floor, his nose in one of Keats's books. There was always a calm period after dinners at the Keats apartment, perfect for just hanging out. Too early for Jason to go to work, too late for me to get my pay card to the bank. I resolved to get up a bit early and deposit the card before practice the next morning. But for now, Noah and I both had no urge to head home. I would have just spent the night on Cass and Jason's floor, but a gentle word from Keats had nudged me into thinking I ought to go home and give my own parents the good news. In a bit. Jason had his phone out again, his brows a heavy line. I'd forgotten all about his mysterious message in the excitement of my announcement, but he obviously hadn't. "Seriously, don't open that file," I said. He tapped at the phone screen a bit, but didn't respond. I nudged him gently. "Jason, did you hear me?" He looked up as though he'd just realized I was sitting next to him.
"My phone's blank," he said.
"It's what? Blank?" I asked. Noah looked up from his book, and Cass stopped pacing.
"Look at this. It's the startup screen."
He held his phone up, and we all peered at it. He was right. The display showed a basic user data form.
"The only way to get that on an old phone is to do a full wipe," I said. "I haven't seen that screen since I bought my own after graduation."
"You opened the file, didn't you?"
"I did not," said Jason defensively. He dropped the phone in his lap. "Okay, maybe I was thinking about it, but I can't. All my messages are gone."
"Noah, is your phone wiped too?" I asked. "Maybe the school did something."
"No, mine is fine," said Noah.
Like Jason, he was still in school, though a year ahead and about to graduate. They both had school-issued phones, which meant the school had final control over their contents.
"You're sure you didn't open the file?" said Cass.
"I said I was sure,"
Jason snapped, and Cass put her hands up in a don't-bite-my-head-off gesture. Jason shook his head.
"What if something happened to Tara?"
"Phones glitch all the time," Cass said, "especially school phones. Don't sweat it."
Jason sighed and stood up.
"I have to get to work."
To get from the Keats's place to mine, I didn't even have to leave the building. The apartment where I'd grown up was three floors down and two halls over. I knew every stain and patch on the plastic carpet, had probably contributed more than anyone to the worn-in path down the center of the hall. I was less familiar with the walls and ceilings, since I tended to walk with my head down, but I could still identify any of the intervening hallways by the holes in the yellow plaster or persistently dripping leaks. I was walking on autopilot. The business with Jason's phone had been strange, but I just couldn't focus on it. Instead, I was thinking about names. Despite the stark differences between the Summerlands and every game that had come before, one tradition had survived across realities. Gamer tags. The most famous were household names. Dr. Agony, Rad, Wolfheart, and Valkyrie, the members of the legendary party Golden Apple, could be seen on t-shirts, VR headsets, and on one memorable occasion, a condom ad that ran only once during the Super Bowl. Our party had a name, of course, Hearthammer. We'd picked it up in a Dungeons & Dragons game that Keats had run for me, Jason, and Cass when we were kids, and it had naturally carried over to our Summerlands party. We also had our own gamer tags, just as we had agreed-upon roles in the party. Cass went by Jessamine, the name of her first D&D character, and more feminine than I would have expected from her, and had gotten dangerously good with a longbow. Noah was called Sephiroth, a great name for a wizard, which he would be in the Summerlands. He was learning white magic the same way I was learning red, by mastering the essential elvish words and practicing the moves hour after hour and hoping we were doing it right. Jason was our muscle, literally as well as figuratively, after years of training with a heavy steel bar in place of a sword. He insisted on calling himself Yukon, even though Cass hated it. Not fantasy enough, she said.
I think he'd heard once that the Yukon Territory far to the north was a place of blue water, green grass, and mild sunlight, like the Summerlands itself, and it had stuck with him. As for me, I'd gone through a few tags, but that night's conversation had helped me finally settle on one. I would be called Linnea, after an 18th-century naturalist who'd invented taxonomy, the discipline of categorizing and organizing living things. It seemed like an appropriate handle for the girl who aimed to be the Summerlands' first proper scientist. I could imagine the cover of my first book, with Linnea across the top in big letters, and Emma Burke underneath it. The halls of our apartment block were normally crowded with a bustling mixture of neighbors and squatters. A lot of folks sat out in the halls to eat their dinners, some out of a sense of community, others to use the public plugs to power their hot plates and rice cookers. Having grown up on the block, I knew most of them, especially on this walk. But I was too caught up in being pleased with myself to notice that the halls were silent and empty. Oh, it was later than I had thought, and the only people still out were squatters curled up under thin blankets in the corners. So I was alone when I heard a familiar, whiny voice.
"Hey, Burke, did you get paid today?"
Jamie Bullard came around the corner of an inset doorway, an oversized hunting knife held loosely at his side. He looked the same as he had at the expedition store earlier, and he certainly had a habit of popping out at you, but there was something new in his eyes that made the back of my neck prickle.
"I get paid every day," I replied.
"Perfect," said Jamie.
His grip tightened on the hunting knife, though he kept his hands down.
"Then you won't mind sharing with me?"
"Come on, you're not a criminal. Why don't you get a job? Then you can share with yourself." My voice was steadier than my nerves. Jamie had bugged me plenty in my life, but never with a knife in his hand, and never with that look in his eyes.
"Don't say that. Everybody knows you're a bleeding heart."
Jamie brought his hands up, spread wide in a mock why-the-hell-not gesture that I guess he thought was an impressive display of casual insolence. In reality, it just exposed a bit of his overhanging belly.
"You give stuff to your heart hammer friends all the time. Christ, you even give stuff to the street kids. I've seen you. So give some to me."
"Jamie, let's talk about this." I took a step back and dared a glance over my shoulder. I wasn't too far from the door to the nearest stairwell, but if I ran, I would expose my back to Jamie and his knife. Plus, he knew the block as well as I did, and no matter where I hid, he would find me.
"Talk about it?"
His gleaming eyes narrowed.
"Nah. Wanna fight about it?"
There it was, the unspoken threat that he held over my head. However big he was, I had spent the last 5 years learning to fight. The way he was standing, I was pretty confident I could get inside his guard, grab the knife, and walk away. The problem was that I would have to hurt him to do it, maybe even break his wrist. I didn't want to in the first place, and if I was successful, I'd feel the full weight of the police on my back within an hour. They wouldn't care that it was self-defense, not with the chief's kid crying and clutching his arm. I couldn't even just hand over my money and trust the law would get it back for me. Despite the police insurance I'd dutifully paid since my first job as a kid, there was no point in filing a complaint that Chief Bullard would just toss in the trash.
"No thanks," I said,
just like he knew I would.
"Come on,"
he whined. His eyes were hungry and his hand on the knife was white and shaking.
"I've seen you out there running around with your little adventuring party. Don't you think it's time to fight a real man instead of imaginary gold dogs?"
"I said I'm good," I said tightly.
"Then give me your pay card,"
he said. So I gave him my pay card. Police statement.
"It's not a big deal, Cass,"
I said for the 100th time. Sitting in the dust field behind our block, I was rolling a quarter over my fingers, and she was putting a new string on her bow. Behind us, Noah murmured the same word of Elvish over and over as he made little arcs with a stick. Cass stood and aimed at me, arrowless, but with the string drawn back to her ear.
"It is a big deal,"
she insisted, glaring at me down the length of her arm.
"You should have kicked his ass. We'll be out of here before long anyway."
"Not if I'm in jail." I passed the coin to my other hand in a satisfyingly smooth motion.
"Why aren't you bothered by this? I'm sick of having to be upset on your behalf all the time. Ugh, it's exhausting."
Cass loosed the string, piercing my heart with an imaginary arrow and a real thrumming snap. I sighed. You shouldn't do that. Without an arrow to absorb the force of the string, it all goes into the bow, Cass finished for me. I know, Professor. Loosen up. I unleashed a string of elvish gibberish and flicked the quarter at her, nailing her square in the chest. Bang, you're dead. If we'd been in the Summerlands, it would have exploded. Maybe.
You had the last word wrong, Noah said.
No, I didn't. I twisted around to look at him. Gira. That's what the book says. Gira. Noah shook his head.
It's not Gira. It's Giru.
Sure, if you go by Ringler, but on Agony's feed... Why do you even know this? It's red magic.
Emma Burke, you're coming with me.
It was Keats's voice, snapping like a whip. I looked up to see Jason standing at his father's side, his shoulders hunched and his eyes locked firmly on his shoes. Keats's neck was red and his mouth was working like he was trying to chew a particularly heinous piece of protein gristle. Bathroom break my ass, I said to Jason as I stood. You sold me out, you rat! Jason just shrugged, but at least he had the decency to look a little embarrassed.
Come on, Emma.
Keats's voice was still tight.
We're going down to the station. Now!
I knew he wasn't mad at me personally, but it was still unnerving to see him like this. Keats, it's really not a big deal, I tried.
Like hell it's not.
He was already walking away, expecting me to follow. I'd always guessed Cass got her stubborn streak from her dad. This was just confirmation.
What's happening right now?
Noah asked. Jason told Keats about Jamie Bullard, I said, then pointed at the boy trying to avoid my eyes. Do the crime, do the time, I told him. You're coming too. The police station was a classic example of lowest bidder, brutalist architecture. The front was all glass, stuck with translucent posters for the department's corporate sponsors. A picture of a gleaming, greasy, cluckin' turducken meal from Cluckaducks made my anxious stomach flip over. Behind the station, the attached jail was a pile of concrete boxes, cell blocks placed like building blocks. The turducken split in half, and we were hit with a puff of canned protein scent as glass doors whooshed open to let us in. The interior was sticky with the body heat of 24 cops, citizens, and handcuffed criminals. No AC in here, which Keats had once told me was an intentional choice to discourage people from hanging around.
Welcome to Hollywood Precinct 5,
chirped a disembodied female voice from somewhere above our heads.
The current wait time is 78 minutes. Please feel free to return any time between 8 a.m. and 6 p.m. if you do not wish to wait.
If it were possible for so busy and crowded a room to fall completely silent, it would have. Clearly, rumor of the mugging had arrived ahead of us. Between the cops, the perps, and a well-dressed woman who looked up as the touchpad where she was entering a complaint began to play a video ad, every face in the lobby turned toward us. I hesitated, half in and half out of the doorway. Grabbing me by the wrist, Keats led me past the reception screens and through a frosted glass door deeper into the station. Jason trotted along sheepishly behind us. The cops in the bullpen stared openly as we passed. Some watched with anger etched into their stony faces, others with fear. One absolutely huge officer stood bent over with his hands planted on the desk of a dark-haired female colleague. His biceps strained against his uniform shirt. His face was red beneath the open visor of his riot helmet, which had the name Porter stenciled on it in worn white paint. He let his gaze linger on us for an intentional moment, then leaned in and whispered something that made the woman laugh, a staccato bark that still hung in the air after she covered her mouth. As he looked back at us, I got the weird but distinct feeling that he wasn't watching me or Keats. He was looking right at Jason. Keats arrived at his desk and quickly opened a new report file on a tablet chained to the desktop. He entered the basics on a touchscreen menu. The date, my name, Jamie's name. From a series of dropdowns, he selected misdemeanor, then theft, then petty. Finally, he looked at me for the first time since we'd entered the station. Far from the growl I was expecting, his voice was soft when he said,
"You need to make a statement for the camera."
"Is that..." I hesitated, feeling my neck and cheeks get hot, keeping my eyes locked carefully on the tablet in Keats's hand. "Is that safe?"
"Yes," said Keats. "For you, at least. The report, the statement, the warrant, everything goes under my badge number. That way you won't be held responsible, and it can't be ignored."
"Okay," I said. If you're sure.
I'm sure.
I did my best to look the camera in the eye as I made my statement. I tried to stick to the basics, leaving out the times Jamie Bullard had bugged me and my friends in the past, but spilling out a nervous overflow of detail about the exact time, the floor and hall, and nearby room numbers where he'd mugged me, and the 6290 he'd taken. I caught myself a moment before divulging exactly why that money was so important to me. Instead, I coughed and finished. And anyway, that's what happened. Thanks. Good luck. Hearing myself say good luck was the worst moment of the whole ordeal. Or so I thought for about 30 seconds as Keats hit a few buttons to log the report. It submitted with a soft ping, and I was just thinking about getting the hell out of there when a door in the back of the bullpen crashed open.
Keats! Office! Now!
The look in Keats's eye as he dragged me and Jason behind him to the chief's office told me that he had known this storm would come. But even so, he seemed a bit surprised at how quickly it had whipped up.
Who the hell is this?
Asked Chief Bullard as soon as we entered. He was looking at me, not Jason. My attempt at passing unnoticed had obviously failed. Invisibility was a white magic spell in the Summerlands anyway. Bullard wasn't a big man, but his uniform was too small. The collar cut into his flushed neck and the Kevlar vest strained its straps. He was loud enough to fill the room anyway.
This is Emma, the girl your son mugged, said Keats. One of yours?
Bullard was straining to keep his temper.
Friend of the family, sir, said Keats.
Friend of the family,
repeated Bullard. His voice was quiet, the rage tucked away for now.
You think you're a good parent, Keats?
Yes, sir, I do,
said Keats. It was the closest I'd ever heard him come to bragging.
Think I'm a good parent? I wouldn't know, sir.
Keats stood at parade rest, hands behind his back, looking Bullard square on. Behind me, Jason kept his eyes down.
I think I am, said Bullard. I'm a decent man, Keats, a good member of the community.
He snorted.
Against the advice of every sergeant on the force, I haven't fired you. You know why? Because on the whole, you make my life easier. You bring crime down. That's good enough for me. But then you go and do this.
He indicated his desk computer, which showed the report we'd just filed.
And it makes my life harder. A lot harder. You know why?
Why, sir?
Said Keats.
Because your family is all you got, Keats. And since Anna died, my boy Jamie is all the family I have. Now look, I know you love your kids. And these strays you pick up, God knows why. So if you had a chance to give your kid an advantage in life, any advantage, wouldn't you take it? You would. You'd do the same.
Keats was silent as Chief Bullard began to pace.
So when my own kid breaks a little law, has a little teenage fun, well, I could bring the hammer down on him, or I could let it slide. And if I let it slide, then when we batch up our records and sell them up for background checks, my kid won't get a red flag or a black mark.
Bullard was crossing and recrossing his office now, looking at the floor, one hand behind his back and the other jabbing at the air as he went. It was really a monologue rather than a conversation, getting louder and louder as it spun on.
But then you had to go and do this,
he waved at the computer again,
and screw it all up. Can't erase a report entered by an officer, God knows why. Good luck ever finding a job with this on your record, Jamie. Poor kid.
Bullard turned on us.
Got anything to say in your defense, Keats? Jason, care to stick up for your old man? How about you, girl? Feel good that you ruined a boy's life over, what was it, $60?
I could barely put together a whole thought, but Keats was more composed. He put his chin up, but all I could see was a man about to get hit on the jaw.
My job is to stop crimes if I can, and report them if I can't, he said. I did my job.
That's how you're gonna play it, huh?
Bullard was quiet again, but his voice was tight with menace.
Fine. Fair's fair. My boy won't be able to find work with this on his record. I'll be stuck supporting him for the rest of my life. So let's say no more work for you, Keats. Let's say your perfect little golden kids can support you until you die. Pack up your things and get the hell out of here and don't come back. Fair?
By the time we made it back to the apartment block, I was late enough for work that I couldn't walk. Luckily, there was a bus that could get me to the expedition store with 4 minutes to spare, but I had to rush for it, so I couldn't be there when Keats broke the news to Cass. I wasn't sure whether to feel guilty or relieved to miss the awkward scene, so I settled on both. To distract myself on the bus, or maybe to pretend for 5 minutes that it was still yesterday, I pulled out my phone and called up one of my favorite Summerlands clips. It was from Dr. Agony's stream, and captured a short fight between his party, Golden Apple, and a group of monsters called Trash Snakes. It was a pretty exciting video, but I loved it because it captured him performing a particularly amazing piece of magic. As the clip began, the four members of Golden Apple, Dr. Agony, Rad, Wolfheart, and Valkyrie, were slogging through what appeared to be an arcane garbage dump. They sloshed through waist-high filth, shards of pottery and bones floating in brown muck. Rad was in the lead, a huge maul in his hands, and he looked back and winked at Dr. Agony's cam. Rad was a mountain of a man with dark skin and a shaved head, and his trademark grin flashed bright in the drone's headlight. He was a hacker like us.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.